A few weeks ago, while Scott Manley and I were kerbling a dinosaur, he mentioned something about NASA bolting two B-52s together at the wing and then using that to launch a space shuttle. Well, I was massively confused, but also obviously intrigued, so I looked it up. So today on Vintage Space, we are talking about the Conroy Virtus. So before we get into the details of this Frankensteinian beast that is two B-52s effectively bolted together, we have to look a little bit about what some of the early plans were for the space shuttle. The space shuttle, as most of you know and many people can see, is heavily inspired by an aircraft design. One of the reasons behind that was that the space shuttle needed to have a large cross-range capability. The idea was you'd be able to launch the shuttle from Florida, have it complete a single orbit around the Earth, and then land on a runway or a dry lake bed in California, namely near Edwards Air Force Base. To do that, the flight worked out such that the shuttle would need to traverse a fair bit of distance during that descending flight. That also meant that the shuttle could theoretically land in California and then need to be transported back to Florida before it could be refurbished and launched on another mission. The original shuttle design actually included turbofan engines on the orbiter itself, or engines that could be attached to the orbiter after it returned from space, such that it would be able to fly itself from California to Florida. These engines could also help the vehicle fly further through the atmosphere if it needed to have more of that cross-range capability. But it turned out the idea of using turbofan engines on the orbiter was just loaded with problems, and so NASA looked at something else, using other vehicles to transport the space shuttle from California to Florida. NASA, of course, did have some experience in transporting large pieces of hardware from California to Florida, specifically stages of the Saturn V rocket. So airlifting the space shuttle from its landing in California to Florida for another launch wasn't out of the question, but it was out of the question to build an aircraft large enough to take the shuttle inside its fuselage. So NASA looked at what else it had familiarity with, and that was air launching vehicles from underneath or underneath the wing of a mothership. Now, we've seen this with vehicles like the X-1, the X-15, and the lifting bodies. These were launched either from underneath the belly of an aircraft, like the bomb bay of the B-29 in the X-1's case, or underneath the wing of a bomber, a B-52, in the X-15's case. Now, of course, the space shuttle is a lot bigger than the X-15, and it wouldn't necessarily fit snugly under the wing of a B-52. And by not necessarily, I mean not at all. But it could fit underneath two combined wings of a B-52. This was the basic configuration of an aircraft called Virtus that was under investigation at NASA Langley in the early shuttle days. The vehicle had a 472-foot wingspan and twin 293-foot fuselages. The wing would cover the width of the two fuselages, effectively giving them a shared central wing. It was underneath the center of that shared central wing that the orbiter would be suspended for transport flights. Turbofan engines on the outer wings of the dual fuselage aircraft would power the plane on its cross-country flights. It sounds kind of bonkers, but this idea was actually investigated. A 134 scale model was put through low-speed wind tunnel tests, and the results were quite encouraging. Really, the biggest drawback of the plane was its sheer size. This thing was going to be massive to build and to engineer and to fly, but it was doable. Having the orbiter suspended beneath the central wing of this dual fuselage plane actually had a lot of aerodynamic benefits, separating the orbiter for its landing once it was delivered from California to Florida. Because the orbiter was effectively dead weight suspended beneath the central wing, once it separated, gravity would draw it down, and the sudden loss of mass would see the transport plane spring up as it got lighter. This meant that there was no danger of the two vehicles crashing in a mid-air collision at the moment of separation. Not to mention, it was also a lot simpler to load the orbiter underneath that central wing than to put it on top of something. Simple winches inside the carrier's central wing could haul the orbiter up into its position and hold it there until the moment of release. The version of the Virtus that was studied most used major elements from the B-52 fuselage, and it had a total wingspan of 450 feet. Either the orbiter, the external tank, or two solid rocket motor cases could be added to the cargo pod underneath that central wing for transport between cities or states. The vehicle would be able to fly at 35,000 feet with a cruise speed of about 300 miles per hour and a maximum range of 3,000 miles. It was also able to carry 375,000 pounds on those cross-country flights. In spite of all of the advantages of the twin fuselage design with the large central wing, it was ultimately deemed easier to just modify an existing jetliner to carry the shuttle on its back, hence the transport aircraft that we're all familiar with. Twin fuselage aircraft may seem a little bit crazy, but we are actually more familiar with them than we realize, because Virgin Galactic is using one today. So what do you guys think of this unrealized space shuttle transportation system? And do you have more questions? Let me know all the things in the comment section below. Be sure to follow me on Twitter and on Instagram for daily vintage space content. And of course, with new videos going up right here every single week, subscribe so you never miss an episode.